Mesrud in his lecture this morning formulated a theorem asserting the existence of what he called a universal deformation ring, which he denoted by R or by R of rho bar. It is my job in this lecture to convince you that this assertion, of which I will give the formulation later in this lecture, is actually correct. Among your conference papers, you found a copy of the issue of the Annals of Mathematics containing the paper of Wiles. And if you read the introduction in there, then you will have found many pieces of interesting information, one of which is that the turning point in his mind in the entire proof lies in his discovery of certain results from commutative algebra that are used to connect this deformation ring to certain Hecker rings. So this is going to be an important ring for the rest of this conference, and these ingredients from commutative algebra that I just mentioned will be dealt with in the first lecture that René Schoof will deliver next week. When I discussed some of these results with experts in commutative algebra, then they would always ask me what additional information was available about this deformation ring R, since they think in general that if a ring arises in a natural manner in number theory or in algebraic geometry, then it should be a ring about which much additional useful information is known. And that is something that does not seem to be the case for this ring R. All one really knows is, well, first of all, that it is a coefficient ring in the sense of Mesrud's lecture this morning, and secondly, of course, that it represents the deformation functor. And indeed, if you look at the first proof that was given of the existence of R, which was given by Mesrud, then that was purely an existence proof. Mesrud made use of certain abstract representability results of functors defined on Artin rings. That is a classical result of Schlesinger's from the late 60s. And since Mesrud did this, and especially since this deformation ring has become important for the proof of Fermat's last theorem, several people have come up with alternative constructions of this ring R that seem at least to have the air of being more explicit and that to many people are psychologically more satisfying. So I will talk in this lecture about one explicit construction and several of the verifications that go into the proof of the properties of R, which are usually quite routine. I may refer you to the handout that you find among your notes, which I wrote together with Bart De Smit. So let me begin with some basic remarks that you must already be familiar with if you acquired your knowledge of elementary algebra from the first chapter in Lang's algebra book. But just in case you didn't, let me talk a little bit in general about universal objects. And I do not want to set this up in an abstract categorical manner. I just want to illustrate this with the construction of free groups, which is actually very illustrative of the several ways in which these deformation rings R can be constructed. So let's take any set S, which we fix for the moment. So if you are Siegel, you will take the empty set. it really becomes interesting when S had at least two elements. And, well, some of you may take S to be a set of primes in the number field, but that is by no means necessary. Now, we will be interested in pairs F, G, where G is a group, just any group, and F is just a set theoretic map from S to G. And we are interested in constructing, among all those pairs, a universal pair. And what do I mean by a universal pair? Well, that means a pair consisting of something that you might call F universal and G universal, with the property that if someone comes up with any pair FG as before, then it factors in a unique way through the universal pair. So you see that even though the words that I am pronouncing and the letters that I am writing are different from those that Mazur wrote, it looks in an aerotechnical sense entirely the same. You will be able to see the analogy with the problem of constructing universal deformation rings. So you ask yourself whether such a universal object exists, and if so, how you can construct it. But it is very important to realize that even before you construct it, you know that if it is there, it is unique in a strong sense. That is to say, if you have two such universal objects, let me call them G1 and G2, then not only are they isomorphic, but they are canonically isomorphic. And this is an important argument, so let me just give it. So if the first pair is universal, then you have an arrow here, a unique arrow that completes the diagram. Let's call it G. And then, since G2 is universal, you have H there. And then the uniqueness hasn't really been used yet, except to convince yourself that G and H are canonical somehow. But next you use uniqueness in order to show that G and H are really isomorphisms by showing that they are each other's inverse, and you do this simply by now looking at the first object again, and you say, well, there is a unique arrow completing this diagram, and it so happens that I know it, it is the identity. But of course, also HG does it, so by uniqueness, they must be the same, and then likewise, GH will be the identity on G2. So, even before you sit down pondering about the existence of such a universal object, you know that it is canonically unique. And that is clearly very important, because that means that if person A constructs the universal object in one way and person B in another, then you know that they are canonically isomorphic, and if those constructions are sufficiently different, then that is a circumstance that can give rise to important properties of G. Okay, so the uniqueness is in a very general sense, and in fact this is a very general argument. I will be a little more precise later about the circumstances in which it applies. The uniqueness is very general, but the existence is always questionable for these things. So in this particular case, it turns out that the existence is actually also correct. And of course, you will already from this section heading here see which group we are going to put here. We are going to place a free group here on an alphabet consisting of letters taken from S. So let me then show you two constructions of this free group that necessarily are going to give the same, but that are very different in spirit. So the first is the following. I look at this S and I map it to a rather large group. And this rather large group, well, you do not hear me say it that clearly perhaps, but when I say group now, it is really group written with a capital letter, since it may not really be a set until I am more precise about this. The index set of this product, I would ideally take to consist of all pairs F, G, as I defined over here. And so the index set of the product is the set of those pairs, and at the FG component, I put my group G, and then there is a natural map from S into this gigantic group. It is a product of many groups, so it is component-wise a group, and this is just defined by taking an element X in S, and then HX has FG's component. By definition, F of X, which happily does live inside this product. And now, in order to complete the construction of the free group, I believe in section 12 of Lang's algebra, you say, okay, let me define in here FS, the free group on S, to be the subgroup generated by the image of H. So that in particular, H will factor through F of S. And then you verify that this group FS, together with H, do form such a universal pair, because if ever you come up with another pair F, G, then the projection on the FG component will make your diagram commutative, and the uniqueness is very easy to derive from the fact that the image of S generates your group. So this is essentially the first construction of the free group that you find in Lang's algebra, and you see that in order to make it completely rigorous, you have to deal with a problem that is not really of an algebraic nature, but of a set theoretical nature. If I really do take all pairs, then I run out of axiomatic set theory and you get problems with logicians. Well, in particular, they derive contradictions. You have to be careful about this. That is certainly not a desirable way of proving Fermat's last theorem. So you have to somehow restrict this to smallish groups. That does not really concern us now. And I may safely refer you to Lang for this. Although there is one thing that I do want to point out. If you listen to what Meiser said in his lecture at the end, he was really interested in finite rings, but when he would construct his universal deformation ring, he would necessarily need to take limits, so he would go into some infinite realm. So really, he was, in a sense, also leaving his finite set theory there. And that is actually something that happens quite often in this whole business of representing functors. So that is the first construction. The second construction is that you just explicitly write down what FS is, and that is also elementary algebra, so let me just write down the keywords so that you can check it in your favorite algebra book. You take what is called the set of reduced words on an alphabet that consists of one copy of S and another copy of S that suggestively is called S inverse. So you take finite words formed out of those letters, the empty word being one of them, you want them to be reduced in the sense that you never want to stand any letter next to its inverse, and on that set you define a group structure essentially by concatenation and cancellation. Sometimes you have a hard time showing it's actually a group. In particular, the associative law requires some trickery. But in any case, after a while, you discover that this is actually a group. Also, my S maps to the free group, just looking at the one-letter words in half of your alphabet, and it is completely straightforward to prove that this is, again, a universal pair, so that it must be the same as the one that was constructed over here. So there you see we have two constructions of the same object, and it is entirely a matter of taste which one prefers. If you look at this construction, then you really see that certainly from an algebraic point of view, very little is happening. If you see this construction, then you get the feeling that you will be able to construct universal objects in essentially every situation, that you will be able to represent every functor, so that gives you a nice and safe sense of power over over mathematics, let's say. And you see that the real problems here, well, as I said, that is really set theoretical and you don't really want to deal with it. But if you start asking questions about this free group, if you decide that it is an interesting object to inspect, for example, you ask yourself a question like, does it have elements of finite order, different from the unit element, then you will really have a hard time telling this fact from this construction. And I basically do not know any proof for that fact, the fact that there are no elements of finite order, that does not essentially proceed by looking at this construction. So this is, in a sense, more work. You have to work harder on getting this free group, but once you have it, you know much more about it. So that is what I will also do. I will work much harder to make my R. It is not clear at all whether I will actually know more about R because I work harder. So let me rephrase this construction of universal objects in terms of representability of functors. So that is quite close to what you heard from Barry already this morning. Suppose that I again fix my set S for the moment, and I have this variable group G, and I am interested in understanding all manners in which you can map S to G, I mean. So you are interested in the set of all maps, let's call it map S, G. And you see that we understand them through group homomorphisms using this universal object. So you have here a bijection, and that is the bijection that that sends my G here to F equal G composed with the universal F. So you have a bijection for varying G, and not only is it a bijection for varying G, it is also what people call functorial in G. So that means that when you vary G, when you have a group homomorphism, let's call it little h, from one G to another G, which is called capital H, then you have induced maps on the left and on the right, just composing with H. This isomorphism which you had here, which really was a bijection depending on G, you also have one here depending on H, And people say that this isomorphism is functorial in G if for every homomorphism between groups, the diagram that you get here is commutative. And if you phrase this in categorical language, then you get the following. Suppose that I look at the category of all groups. So that is what my G is varying over. And I define two functors from the category of groups to the category of sets. The first one is taking homomorphisms from my free group to the varying group, and the other one is taking set theoretic maps from S to G, then you see that for all practical purposes, these two functors can be identified. They always give isomorphic results, and not only does that isomorphism give you the same sets, it also gives you the same maps between them. So if you are interested in understanding these mysterious animals, maps of a fixed set S to a varying group G, then you can study that by means of group homomorphisms starting from one single universal group G that depends on S, it is the free group on S. So in this situation, people say that this usually mysterious functor is represented by this object. And people will say that these functors are equivalent, and that the system of bijections beta gives you an equivalence. And this use of language is really reversible, because you see in this diagram, my universal map F does not appear anymore. It was only used to define the map beta, the system of maps beta. But it turns out that you can recover the universal map F universal just from knowing all those betas, simply by saying, well, if I want to get the universal map, I better take G equal to the identity. So if you substitute for G the free group itself, then you see that the identity map here maps to my universal map. So B G beta G universal of the identity map there is equal to my F universal. So this is, well, it doesn't look as if it is a big deal, but this is actually something that people refer to as Yoneda's lemma. So Yoneda's lemma, if you ever see Yoneda's lemma, then you have to substitute the identity map somewhere. And again, it is true that if you are given a functor, a set-valued functor, and you want to represent it, then you know already before you start that the representing object, if it exists, is unique. That is again Yoneda's lemma, that is basically the same argument that I gave before. So the whole problem is, given your functor, can you represent it? And that was really a very hot issue in the late 60s. I remember that, I think this was around 1970, I went to an algebraic geometry meeting in Oslo. Everybody was representing functors there, and they were carrying Schlesinger's paper under their arms and asking questions about it. And, well, I sort of looked at this and I decided that I wanted to do real mathematics, and I started solving Diophantine equations. Oslo is a great city for solving Diophantine equations. And nowadays we know that if you want to solve Diophantine equations, you have to start by representing a functor, so that's so that's what I'm doing today. Okay, now, let me, before I leave these groups, make one more remark, and that is that sometimes, also in the case of the universal deformation ring, people are interested in imposing additional conditions on their set. For example, they may have some favorite element in S, and they want that it maps to something of order at most 5 or something. So then you get into the business of groups with generators and relations. And you have to remark that once you have free groups, then groups with generators and relations are very easy to construct, because you simply start from your free group without the relations, and you divide out by the normal subgroup generated by your relations. So in a sense, the hardest group with generators and relations that you can construct is really the one without relations. And that is also true for this universal deformation ring. At a certain moment, those deformations are going to be subjected to additional conditions, and it turns out that once you have the universal deformation ring without additional conditions, then the additional conditions can be taken care of separately in the end just by checking a few formal properties. So I will, for the rings again, restrict to the basic case. Let me illustrate this situation of adding additional restrictions with an example that is closer to what we are heading for, namely the situation not of free groups, but free rings. And when I say ring, then I will usually mean, at least for 10 minutes to come, commutative ring with unit element. So suppose that I do the very same thing over here, except that I'm not interested in mapping my S to a group, but to a ring. So then you want to represent that in some universal manner. So then you need somehow to make a ring out of your symbols in S in a manner that has, so to speak, no relations. And if you think about this, then you will see that the representing object is a polynomial ring in just as many variables as you have elements in S. So since I talk about commutative rings, I just take the ordinary commutative polynomial ring. So the fact that this represents my functor of maps from S to my varying object A simply means that there is a natural bijection between the set of ring homomorphisms from my free ring to my varying ring with values in this set of maps. So, and clearly, the image of XS is the same as the image of S over here, that is completely similar to the situation of free groups. And, of course, again, you can construct this polynomial ring by some fancy infinite product, and then you will not even know that it is free over Z. And if you make it in the more traditional 19th century fashion, then you will be able to prove that it is unique factorization. Okay, now suppose that I am actually interested in imposing restrictions on this map. For example, suppose that S is not just any set, but it is actually the underlying set of a group. And I'm not interested in any map to a ring, but I'm interested in group homomorphisms. So that means that I have to rename everybody. But now I want to add relations to my ring that reflect the fact that I'm looking at maps with an additional property. So what does it mean for a map to be a group homomorphism? Well, certainly it means that whenever you take two elements of the group, then their image should be the same, the product of the images should be the image of their product. So then you have at least a multiplicative map to the ring. And if you think about it, then that is almost but not quite sufficient. You still have to prevent everybody from being mapped, for example, to zero. So let's just make sure that the unit element, let E be the unit element of G, that the unit element maps to one. So there you see that the representing object for the functor that maps A to the set of group homomorphisms of G to A star, the representing object is this particular ring. It is just my free ring modulo certain relations. So that is certainly satisfactory from the point of view of representing your functor and constructing your universal object. Of course, you can start asking now whether this is a ring that you already know somehow or that you recognize. And if you think about it for a moment, then you will see that this is actually a ring that does already have a good name. Namely, it is a group ring, not quite of G itself, because I've been talking about commutative rings only, but about the abelianized group. So G ab is just G modulo its commutator subgroup. And when you stare at these rings, you will see that there is an obvious isomorphism between the two. And actually, I feel the easiest way to see that these rings are isomorphic is by showing that they represent the same functor. So that is the way in which group rings are also examples of universal objects. And I have been talking about functors, set-valued functors on the category of rings here. If you like to see group rings over more general rings, so let me take some ring that I call script O, because my base ring later on will be script O, then you get it in the same way, except that now you want to look at O algebras, rings provided with a given ring homomorphism from O to it. So then you get group rings of abelian groups over general coefficient rings. Well, this is already getting quite close to the theorem that Maeser mentioned this morning. Namely, he did have, well, perhaps not quite O algebras, but he had at least a certain type of rings with a given finite residue class field. And he was interested in mapping, well, not really any group, but at least a profinite group, and, well, not really quite to the units, but to the group of invertible n by n matrices over my ring. And that is encouraging, because this is actually the group of n by n matrices over the ring if I take n equal to 1. Thank you. So you see that if Wiles had been able to get away with n equal 1, then the lecture would almost be over. So let's first do the same thing, but now with bigger matrix rings. So I take any base ring O, script O, and I look at the functor, and I take G, a group. Both of them are fixed for the moment. I look at the category of O algebras that I send to the category of sets by sending A. Oh, I also take some integer n, positive integer n. N equals 0 is something that I leave as an exercise. Let's map A to the set of group homomorphisms of G with values in GLN A. And the question is, can you find a representing object? Can you find a universal way of doing this over some ring? And indeed, if you think about this, then there is a canonical way, an obvious way of generalizing this construction. So your representing object, what is it going to be? Well, you start from your base ring O. Now, instead of adjoining for each group element a single element, we need to adjoin an entire matrix. So let's let for every group element, let's just adjoin n square variables and impose the conditions that express the fact that when I map G to this matrix, that is going to be a group homomorphism. So that simply means that I want, the identity of the group goes to 1. And I also want that when I multiply the G's and the A's matrix, then I get a GH1. So I get here some sum. I hope that I do this right. This is sum over L. And I just want that to be equal. So I subtract and I put it all in an ideal. So this is for I and J from 1 through N, and for G and H in the group. So there you see quite visibly that you have a representing object, and the verification is, as before, completely straightforward. Now, it would of course be nice if at this point I could say, well, this is a ring that you know already, just as I did in the case n equal 1 when it was just a group ring. And in fact, I do not know this ring at all. It's not even obvious, for example, whether it shares with the case n equal 1 the property of being free as an O module. So let me just, if you want to play around with this, give you an exercise. Let me just, for shorthand, call this OGN, just sort of to suggest that we are generalizing some sort of group ring notation here. So here's my exercise, which was suggested to me by Bertha Schmidt. Prove that the very simplest case, well, supposing that you think that Z is the simplest ring, questionable assumption perhaps in this conference, I take a cyclic group of order 2, call it C2, and I look at 2x2 representations. And then, well, I could really formulate a vague exercise stating, you know, what is this ring? Somehow describe it in more familiar terms. But let me just have a test question here, prove that this one is free as an abelian group. Now, I think that when you do this exercise, then you will be convinced that these rings really look like nothing. They happen, well, this one doesn't even look decent. It happens to be free. Here's another exercise. I put a star there. You can really only do it with the material that I will talk about later on. And that is the following. If P is a prime number, and I take it at least 7, I didn't think too hard about the small primes, then when you take the following ring, I take again Z. Now I take a somewhat more interesting group. I take the 2x2 matrices over the field with P elements. And I again look at homomorphisms to 2x2 matrices. Then this ring, if you look at its additive group, then it has P torsion. Interesting exercise, which shows in particular that it is not some general statement that these rings are always free as modules over the base ring. So let me now get to the deformation ring. So let me set up the notation, which is slightly different from Berry's notation. I hope that this will not be too confusing. So I take my script O, which I already talked about, now to be any local Noetherian ring. And I take K to be its residue class field. So MO denotes the maximal ideal of O, and K is a residue class field. So, for example, you can take K to be finite, for example, a prime field. And if you want to recover Mayser's theorem from this morning, from what I'll be saying, then for K equal FP, you would have to take O equals ZP. And if you have other finite fields, you have to take appropriate unramified extensions of ZP. But this is all I really will need. I take G to be a profinite group, a projective limit of certain finite groups that I call G alpha over some directed index at alpha. So that is Mayser's capital pi. And then we take a representation of G over the residue class field. So let's call the representation space V. So that is an n-dimensional. So what is n? N is just a positive integer. V is an n-dimensional K vector space that is equipped with an action of G, and that should be a continuous and K-linear action. So when we suppose, as we do, that V has a discrete topology and G has the crude topology, then I want this map to be continuous. And so you may think of this as, if you want to do this explicitly, it is given by some homomorphism. If we choose a basis of V over K, then it is given by a continuous homomorphism from G to GLNK. And I will always assume that rho bar is absolutely irreducible. And what this means and what it implies has been explained this morning by Barry Mayser. So that is what we start from. And next, let me remind you of the objects that we are trying to understand. Those are the deformations. Well, it turns out that it is a little more convenient for me to enlarge the collection of coefficient rings. So let me look at my collection of coefficient rings. So that is a category of complete local O algebras A with residue class field equal to K. So let me explain what I mean by this. So residue class field equal to K, I really mean that the residue class field is the same as K as an O algebra. So that means when I map A to its residue class field, call it A modulo MA, and I compare that, there's a structure map from O to A, to the residue class field of K, K of O, then I want that there is an identification isomorphism that makes this square commutative. So really, I do not want to change residue class fields. Complete local. By this, I mean that A is a projective limit of AI, where AI are Artinian. So when you think of K as being finite, then this just means that AI is finite. And if I say AI is Artinian, then I mean, in addition, that AI satisfies the other conditions. It should be, well, local, let's say, local Artinian, but it should still be an O algebra, and it should still have residue class field K. Certainly it is true that the rings that Berry talked about are contained in this category. They have, in addition, the property that they are Noetherian, but I find it more convenient to deal with the Noetherian condition a little later. And correspondingly, I have no finiteness condition on my profinite group G. Okay, so those are the rings that I will be looking at, and I will be interested in a deformation, in deformations of V to A, so A deformation of V to A is a free A module. It is essentially the same as my definition here, except that I now work over A rather than over K. A free A module, let's call it W, of rank the same N, with a continuous A linear G action. Now you have to be a little bit more careful about what you mean by this, because my W is now also acquiring a topology. W is isomorphic with A to the N, and A has a topology from the projective limit here, and W gets a topology, just a product topology when you choose a basis, but it is easily seen to be independent of the choice of the basis. So then if you put W here, you want the action just to be continuous, but now with something less trivial going on in the module. A continuous A linear G action, such that it has something to do with V, and what it has to do with V is that if you pass to the residue class field, then you get something that is isomorphic, not just as a K module, but also as a G module. So this is, again, of course, also something that can be phrased in terms of matrices. Namely, if you choose your basis for V and you lift it to a basis for W, then all I'm talking about is a continuous map rho from G to GLN A in such a manner that when you map it down to GLN K, well, then this triangle is not quite, well, then it is actually commutative, but it is not quite the case that the W's correspond one-to-one to the rows. You really only look at strict equivalence classes of rows. So if you have two rows, then you call them equivalent. If you have a matrix that transforms one row into the other row, that should be an invertible matrix. And it is, in this absolutely irreducible case, actually easy to see that you can always choose such a matrix, if it exists, to be in the kernel of this arrow down here. So equivalence or strict equivalence, that really makes no difference when you talk about absolutely irreducible residual representations. Okay, so that is the deformation phrased both in terms of modules and of equivalence classes of liftings of the representation. Excuse me. I just require that this is that there is an isomorphism here. Yeah, right. So if you want to phrase it in terms of matrices, you have to you give yourself an isomorphism. Well, you just say W is going to be A to the N anyway. V is K to the N, and you just do it. But then you have to figure out your choices, and that is just the equivalence of the row and the row prime. Okay, so the theorem is that the functor that goes from my category C to the category of sets, sending A to the set, let's call it DEF V, A of deformations of V to A, is representable in other words, there is a universal deformation over some universal, let's call it D, over some universal ring R. And that universal deformation D over that universal deformation R has the property that whenever someone comes up with any A and any deformation W as before, then you can find a unique ring homomorphism, a morphism in C, so that will be an continuous O algebra homomorphism from R to A, such that W is gotten as an AG module from the universal deformation, which I called D, by tensoring it with A over R, where this is done through the map G. So this is exactly the same as what Barry Mazur mentioned this morning, and if you...
How is that the A a set yet?
Yeah, that is true. So I view those W's up to AG isomorphism, you are right. So this is viewed up to isomorphism over AG. So two deformations are viewed as being the same when they are AG isomorphic. Thank you. Okay, so let me just write down what this ring is going to be, and for this I start from the rings OGN that I defined earlier, but now I have to take into account a few special properties, for example all of the topologies that are involved, as well as the fact that I have a given residual representation. So let's write my G as a projective limit of certain finite discrete quotients, and let's choose those quotients in such a manner that when you look at my given residual representation over little k, then they all factor through all g alpha. So that is certainly something that you can do, because the image of G in here is discrete, and therefore it is finite. So that means that you have now an n-dimensional representation of G alpha over some O algebra, and we know that those representations correspond to ring homomorphisms from my modified group ring, OG alpha n, to the ring, in this case K, that the representation happens over. So this has a kernel, which is a maximal ideal in this generalized group ring, which I call M alpha. So now, what I do to this O algebra, which is Noetherian actually, O is Noetherian, I've only finitely many elements in my G, it follows from Hilbert's basis theorem. What I do to my algebra is that I push it into my category C, even in the Noetherian part of it, simply by completing it with respect to this maximal ideal. So then we are sitting in C, and now what we do is that we exploit the fact that there are maps between the G alphas and they are compatible with these representations, so using the appropriate universal properties of these rings, you see that you have maps between these rings, and therefore you can take projective limit over here. And inside this ring, I remind you that inside the original ring here, I had those matrix coefficients, xij, g alpha for every element, little g alpha and capital G alpha. And the same is true here. If I take any element G with coordinates, with projections G alpha in my profinite group G, then I can simply piece together in the projective limit all those matrix coefficients, and I get for every element in my profinite group a nice matrix over this big ring, this big projective limit. And that will actually be a representation of this profinite group, a continuous representation over this ring. It will also be a deformation of rho bar. Now, this is not yet the universal deformation ring, because I have not yet divided out by the equivalence. So what I do in order to get R, I simply look inside, and capital R is defined to be the closed sub O algebra that is generated. Yeah, clearly I do not want to leave my category, so I do need to stick to O algebras that are closed, and I want it to be generated by the traces of this universal representation that I just wrote down, the closed sub O algebra generated by all elements. Well, take the sum of I is 1 to n of xiij, where small g ranges over my entire profinite group, capital G. So this is all there is to the construction of the universal ring R. And before you can sit down and verify that it has the required property, I do have to construct my universal deformation D as well. I have to show that the representation given by these matrices is actually equivalent to one that has coordinates in capital R. And the way you do this is by using Mazur's proposition 3. This was called the descent proposition due to Serre, and it was in a the theory in context, but it is just as valid in this context, and it shows that as long as your subring contains the appropriate traces and your residual representation is absolutely irreducible as it is, you can actually realize a representation by a different choice of basis over R. So that gives you your universal deformation D, and once you know what D is, it is an entirely routine matter to verify that R has all of the properties that I mentioned. And if you want to see the details, then I have to refer you to the notes, and I will also, by lack of time, refer you to the notes for the ingredients of a proof that if G satisfies Mayser's finiteness condition, then this universal ring R actually ends up in the Noetherian part of my category C. So here you see that you have a more or less explicit way of describing your ring. If you understand these generalized group rings and you feel familiar with completions and projective limits, and you also feel happy about passing to subrings, then you will see that R is relatively understandable. Now, subrings in general do not have many good properties, but this R is sitting inside here in a very nice manner. If you want to have an exercise, then you can show that my big ring here is isomorphic as an R algebra to a power series ring in n square minus 1 variables. And if you want to have a hint for this exercise, well, the obvious hint is to show that these rings represent the same functors. Okay, I thank you for your attention.